in your Bibles to Romans chapter 1. That's Romans chapter 1. We're going to examine verses 17 through 20 this morning. Verses 17 through 20 of Romans chapter 1. Verse 17. For in it God's righteousness is revealed from faith to faith, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. For God's wrath is revealed from heaven against all godlessness and unrighteousness of people who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. Since what can be known about God is evident among them, because God has shown it to them. From the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, that is, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood through what he has made. As a result, people are without excuse. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, right now, God, this word, this is your word. And Lord, as we dig through Romans, and we try every week here for the next many weeks, Lord, as we get through 16 chapters of Romans, I pray that you help us to understand what your gospel message is. Lord, help us to understand the severity of rejection of God's Son. Lord, help us to understand the message that Paul has for us. Speak to us in a mighty way, God. I pray your Holy Spirit would move among us. And Lord, prepare our hearts right now. I pray you would soften hearts that we can hear your word and that we can respond to it. And God, if there are those here today that don't know your Son, Jesus Christ, what an opportunity today to hear what the gospel message is. And I pray that they will come to the saving power of Jesus Christ. And for those of us that are believers, that are trusted in Jesus Christ alone for our salvation, I pray today that you would encourage us, that Lord, you would convict us, and just draw us into that right relationship that we should have with you. Lord, right now we ask that you remove all of the obstacles in our minds and our hearts that might hinder hearing your word. Help us to hear your word this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now last week, we took a journey. We took an introduction to Paul's letter here, his epistle to the Romans. And of course, we talked about how the Romans is basically the gospel according to Paul. Now this is concluded here today by a brief summary of the gospel in verses 17 and 18. And then we'll go into what is the guilt of the godless in verses 19 and 20. So verse 17, if you'll look with me real quick again here. For in it God's righteousness is revealed from faith to faith, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. Now, here, God's righteousness is revealed. This word righteousness will be our key word this morning. It appears over 30 times in one form or another in the book of Romans. First, Paul here spells out the revelation of that righteousness with this statement. For in it, God's righteousness is revealed from faith to faith. Now, this word righteousness means the state or the condition of conforming to God's law, to His perfect law, and to His holy character. It means doing what God commands. It means obedience to God. God is righteous. God has righteousness, and God gives righteousness. Now that righteousness which God is in Himself, He provides in Christ Jesus. And this must be accepted by faith, by simple trust. And Paul says that this righteousness is revealed in the good news of salvation. It is as simple as God is righteous and man is unrighteous. Now the good news of the gospel displays how the righteousness of God can be lavished on sinful man, can be lavished on those who are unrighteous. So if righteousness means a right relationship with God, that's probably the simplest term that I can give you, a right relationship with God. Unrighteousness is the opposite. It's a wrong relationship with God. Now, Paul talks about from faith to faith, meaning the righteousness of God is received by faith and is reproduced by faith. Now, John MacArthur, he states that perhaps Paul's point is that the righteousness from God is completely on the basis of faith from beginning to end. So first, we had the revelation of righteousness. Secondly, Paul spells out the revolution of that righteousness is. What did he say? The righteous or the just, your version might say just, will live by faith. Now what is just? Those that are justified, those that have placed their faith in Jesus Christ alone for their salvation, it means that they're justified, that they're declared righteous before God. We become just or righteous. And then in turn, we live. Now this great statement is not something Paul just came up with here in the New Testament. It's from Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. And Paul uses this to show that it's not some new idea that he's just thrown upon the people in Rome. But he's simply reiterating what has always been, even since Old Testament times, that righteousness is by faith. And he emphasizes that true faith is not a single event, but a way of life. It endures. Now catch that. True faith, true righteousness, being justified before God, is not a one-time event. It's not, okay, Paul, I'm going to come down today with you and I'm going to pray with you. I'm going to pray the sinner's prayer. I'm going to receive all that you talk about. You talk about Jesus dying and being resurrected, ascended into heaven. I receive all of that. That's great. 10, 15 years, 30 years from now, we're sitting together. And maybe I'm in a counseling session with you. You say, well, Paul, I prayed that prayer. But within that month, all of a sudden, I was a drug abuser. I was a drunk. I was involved in every kind of sexual perversion you can imagine. I just lived a life of sin for the last 30 years, 10 years, 15 years, whatever it may be. Was there true faith there displayed? Did you truly receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Faith, you will live by faith. It's not a single event. It's a way of life that endures. Now please, don't go out here saying Paul was teaching his works, that you can work your way to God. That's not what I'm saying at all. What I'm saying is if you came down and you prayed with me, or you prayed with someone else, or you just prayed on your own, you opened the Bible, you said, Jesus, save me. I believe all this about you. And if you're truly saved, then you would be transformed. You wouldn't continue to live a lifestyle. Now catch that, a lifestyle of sin. Now all of us, I've been saved 20, 24 years now. And there have been days, there have been bad days in my life. All of us sin day in and day out at some point or at times. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying if you can live in a state of sin, either you're back the way you were before and you profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or maybe you're even worse than you were before. Have you been truly born again? That's what we talked about this week at BBS. We tried to explain the best we could to these young children what it means to be born again. If you're a new creature, Paul says, you do new things. You can't continue to live a lifestyle of wickedness and unrighteousness. In the Antarctic summer of 1908, Sir Ernest Shackleton and three of his companions attempted to travel to the South Pole from their winter quarters. And they set off with four ponies to carry their heavy load. Weeks later, their ponies dead, rations all but exhausted, they turned back toward their base, their goal never accomplished. Altogether, they trekked 127 days, and on the return journey, as Shackleton records in his book, The Heart of the Antarctic, the time was spent talking about food, elaborate feasts, gourmet delights, sumptuous menus. And as they staggered along, suffering from dysentery, not knowing whether they would survive, every waking hour was occupied with thoughts of eating. Jesus, who also knew the ravages of food deprivation, he said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. We can understand Shackleton's obsession with food, which offers but a glimpse of the passion Jesus intends for our quest, on our quest for righteousness. Just the way Shackleton and his men, they hungered and they thirsted for food. They had to have food. They needed it so badly. They wanted to get to that food. All they could think about it consumed their minds and their hearts. I've got to have something to eat. That's the same attitude that we must have if we're truly born again. That should be your attitude. I hunger and I thirst for righteousness. It consumes me. It consumes my soul and my heart and my life. That's my question.